Smart trade. Maybe the Braves can take the series again this year.
Oh, I say, that's excellent. Absolutely smashing.
Sounds like you're reading something mighty interesting there. You mind if I ask you what it is?
Oh, not at all, old chap, not at all. It's the obituary column of the New York Times.
The New York Times obituaries? What's so funny about that?
It's just the thought of all those dead Americans.
Huh?
My dear fellow, do forgive me if I perplex you. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Reginald Hastings Marduke. I'm an Englishman, of course. I'm what in my country is known as a Cambridge Don. Actually, I'm Regius Professor of Modern Philosophy at Trinity College, Cambridge. You might say my specialty is American civilization, so I have something of a hobby of collecting dead Americans. In a purely figurative sense, of course.
Well, how about that, a professor from Cambridge? So, let me ask you, Mr. Marduke, or should I say, Professor.
Well, in actual fact, I am a member of the House of Lords, a rather active member, although we do have our passive members on the back benches. So you may address me as Lord Marduke.
Well, how about that? A British Lord. Well, you know the old saying, everybody loves a Lord? Well, welcome to the United States, Lord Marduke.
Thank you, old chap.
My name is Tom Gall.
Very glad to make your acquaintance. Very kind of you, quite.
Anyway, Lord Marduke, what brings you to this side of the old pond?
Oh, it's part of my job, you see. I'm thoroughly devoted to the Anglo-American special relationship. I'm here to sample American attitudes at the outset of the new presidential contest. I flew in yesterday on the Concorde. I thought I could ring up a few of my old friends, but I couldn't find anybody in their offices. quite frustrating, actually. And that's why I'm taking my tea time out here. Taking a break, as you Americans say.
Oh, Lord Marduke, it's a holiday here. President's Day, you know? Like Lincoln and Washington.
Oh, those. Those two. But I should have thought that Lincoln was born on February 12th and Washington on the 22nd. Am I correct?
You're right, Lord Marduke. But the two holidays have been merged, and it's being observed today.
Observed, is it? Well, I must say that these celebrations are rather subdued.
You're right, Lord Marduke. You ask any American today what they know about George Washington, and they'll say something about a cherry tree or something. And Lincoln, born in a log cabin, that he helped his father build. Well, but there's not a lot more than that. Unless you need to buy something on sale. Hey, great bargains in the stores around now.
Well, of course you're right, my dear fellow.
Well, anyway, Lord Marduke, are you over here to see who wins the primaries? I mean, is there any special candidate you're following?
In actual fact, we always take the longer view, the deeper view, I should say.
How do you mean?
We're less concerned with personalities. These come and go. Although occasionally we help speed them on their way. We attribute greater importance to the underlying belief structure, the mental map of reality, the axioms, so to speak. We like to focus on those. If those are changing, we would like to know right away.
Wow, it sounds like that goes way over my head.
Not necessarily, old boy. I'm sure we can find a common ground. In fact, we Anglo-Saxons have always stood together on the most important matters. You know, I've always felt that your War of Independence was nothing other than a terrible misunderstanding. A terrible mistake. All due to that fellow, that bungling nincompoop North.
You mean Ollie North?
Oh. Oh, no. I mean Lord North. He was our ghastly prime minister that treated you Yanks so badly that you turned against the crown and the mother country. It was so needless. It was only those wretched politicians that were at fault. And we've been paying a terrible price ever since. We've lost the unity of the Anglo-Saxon race and the English-speaking peoples. Although, in spite of everything, we've always been your staunchest allies.
I couldn't agree with you more, Lord Marduke.
Please, call me Reggie.
Reggie, you are so right. You people are just so civilized. And you have such style and class. And everything we have, we owe to you, starting with the English language. And your British traditions of liberty, democracy, individual liberty and fairness, why, where would we be without you?
Where indeed? You're quite right, old chap. The marvelous thing about you Yanks is your solid tradition of good old common sense. That's why we get along so well. And you know, it all goes back to a wonderful old fellow by the name of John Locke. Do you know of him?
You bet I do. He's the father of our Constitution. In fact, he's practically the founder of the entire American way of life. I mean, anybody with any brains knows that.
Bravo, old chap, bravo. I sense the beginning of a very wonderful friendship. And the genius of old John Locke was the extraordinary way he understood the working of the human mind. Aristotle was right, after all. It all depends on the data we get from our senses. Sense impressions. We have the olfactory, the gustatory, the visual, the auditory, and the tactile. And those sense impressions get fed into the brain like little marbles. And the wonderful thing about the brain is that it can take those marbles and arrange them in patterns. And voila, we have new ideas. Nihil in intellectu, quod non prius in sensu.
Huh?
There's nothing in your mind which isn't in your senses first. Pardon my Latin, but it couldn't be clearer.
Really, you're right on the money, Reggie. I mean, I don't want any pipe dreams and off-the-wall theories. I mean, I want something I can sink my teeth into. What I can see, what I can taste and smell, what I can hear, what I can reach out and touch. That's what I know is real. Those are the facts. And there, I know I can't go wrong. Seeing is believing, I always say. And that's what all my friends say, too.
Very cogent, old boy. And then we have cause and effect in the world of facts. You light the candle, the flame produces heat, and the wax begins to drip. The flame causes the dripping. Or you take one billiard ball, it hits another and causes motion. Cause and effect.
That cuts right through all the fluff. That gets right to the heart of the matter.
Quite. And the extraordinary thing about old Locke is that he explained when a child comes into the world, there's nothing at all in his mind. The child's mind is like a blackboard with no chalk. And it's up to us to fill the empty spaces on that tabula rasa. A clever old fellow, John Locke.
And in my opinion, we've got to recognize what human nature really is. You know, every time I call up my stockbroker, I have to think about how the market works on fear and greed. I mean, I want to make a killing, but I'm scared of getting blown out, you know, when the bottom drops out of the market. It's pleasure and pain, you know. If everybody could just, pursue their own self-interest, why, the outcome would be a better world for everybody. Just the market, unregulated, without any government interference, without that big bureaucracy that's always on our backs. You know, less government and more power to the private sector. In my view, the whole problem is Washington.
Yes, he was a rather beastly fellow.
Huh? Oh, well, I guess it does go all the way back to him. I mean, he founded the government. But, you know, my opinion is just as good as anybody else's. That's democracy.
Yes, of course it is, old boy. And now that we're having this wonderful little conversation, I think there is another of these ancient worthies that we should also mention. Thomas Hobbes. He wasn't having any of your bleeding heart liberalism. Nature and the state of nature is the war of all against all, where every man is a wolf to his neighbor.
You know, that's why we need the death penalty. You know, we need the electric chair, the gas chamber, and the more cruel and unusual, the better, to keep the criminals in their place. And we need more judges, tougher judges, more prisons, stiffer sentences, and no parole, along with less government, of course.
Yes, that's exactly what old Hobb wanted. I'm very proud of old Hobb. He's in my family tree, you know. I've always been very fond of Hobb.
You know, Reggie, I can't help but thinking that we've left out one great name. You know, like a lot of Americans, I'm interested in science and engineering. Mm. And for my money, the greatest of them all is Sir Isaac Newton. You know, I think of Newton every time I see the space shuttle go up. None of this could have been done without Sir Isaac Newton. I saw on Walt Disney back in the 50s, when I was a kid, that every action has an equal and opposite force and reaction.
Just as the poet had it, nature and nature's laws were wrapped in night. God said, "Let Newton be!" And all was light. Tom, if I may call you Tom, I've always been touched by the idea of Newton's that bodies attract each other. Action at a distance, how delightful. And of course, this mysterious attraction is equal to inversely proportional to the square of the distance. And that's what makes the world go round, as you Yanks say.
It's the bedrock of modern science, Reggie. You know, it's a real pleasure talking to you because we might come from totally different backgrounds and, you know, lead a lot different lives, but I'm glad to see that we can agree on just so much.
Quite.
And there you have the problem. Every person, whether they know it or not, is a philosopher. Each of us necessarily develops a theory of how the world works, expressed as a set of axioms. The axioms are self-evident ideas that define human nature, the content of history, the workings of economics, the purpose of government, the goals of life. The problem is that today most of the world, and certainly most Americans, subscribe to axioms which are false. As a result, they tend to oppose the very measures that might help to overcome the world crisis. Public opinion has become the most dangerous component of American life. Is there a remedy? It must be to uncover the false axioms, uproot them, and replace them with the truth. History and philosophy must lead the way. The crisis of the citizen needs to be seen in a long historical perspective. We need to look at the 500 years since the Italian Renaissance opened the modern era. Before the Renaissance started, about 1400, there is a discouraging sameness in human societies. Some are better, some are worse. But they are generally two class systems, ruling elite and mass. The mass made up 95% of the population. They were peasants, serfs, and slaves, almost always laboring on the land, almost always illiterate and benighted. Their lives were nasty, brutish, and short. Over these peasants and serfs commanded a feudal aristocracy. Monarchy is generally bad enough, but most of these pre-Renaissance societies were something worse. They had small ruling classes called oligarchies. These aristocrats had military retainers, priests, scribes, and lackeys, making up at most 5% of the population. Under these conditions, world population potential was measured in the hundreds of millions, and even these were decimated by frequent plagues and famines. Now and then, a good ruler might appear, and did appear, along with excellent philosophers and scientists. But the oligarchy was always present, waiting to reinfect the society with usury, constant warfare, slavery, racism, and the philosophy of Aristotle. Oligarchs come in many forms, all ignorant and brutal. The barons of the Dark Ages, the Russian boyars, the East European magnates, the French frondeurs, the princes of the Holy Roman Empire, all of these were easily manipulated by the Venetians, who had inherited the methods of Babylon, Rome, and Byzantium. So from about 1000 AD until about 1600, the leading center of oligarchy in Europe and in nearby Asia was Venice. Transcending the two-class model started with Dante and Petrarch and culminated with Cusanus, Leonardo, and the Italian Renaissance of the 1400s. The apex of the Renaissance was the Council of Florence in 1439, sponsored by the Medici. This council for a time reunited the Christian world and embraced the theology of Imago Viva Dei, humanity and the human individual created in the image of God, sharing with God the divine qualities of intellectual creativity in the form of a human soul. The dignity of the human person had to be respected. The human mind was capable of scientific discovery and also capable of creating the modern nation state. The impulse from the Council of Florence reached around the world with Columbus and the Florentine Amerigo Vespucci, the Medici envoy who gave his name to the new continents called the Americas. It offered the modernization of Russia, and the same impulse of human progress reached into France, where King Louis XI used Florentine methods to create the first modern national state. This required breaking the power of the turbulent feudal aristocracy and their private armies. Louis fought the nobles with every means, including taxation, which also funded a modern state administration. Louis XI had a social base in the commercial and manufacturing classes of the cities and towns, the precursors of the modern middle class. As king between 1461 and 1483, Louis XI promoted industry and commerce. He protected the rights of labor, enacted public health statutes, built infrastructure, drained swamps, and built up a national army. The population and prosperity of France increased accordingly. France was the first large nation to reach the takeoff point into the modern age. French military power also grew. This was soon noticed by the new Tudor regime in England, as well as by the rulers of Spain. It was clear that the future belonged to the larger nation states that were smart enough to imitate the methods of Louis XI. If the Louis XI model were to prevail everywhere, there was the hope that the oligarchs as a class might be crushed. The momentum of Renaissance art, science, and statecraft might overwhelm all resistance and become unstoppable. The oligarchy was parasitic and obsolete. It deserved nothing but extinction. The Renaissance had shown that humanity did not need oligarchs. Venice was the leading oligarchical state. If Venice had been wiped out, the oligarchy would have disappeared from Europe and soon from the face of the earth. The Venetians had been waging their own war against Florence and the other Italian Renaissance states for a century. The Venetians carefully studied events in France. Venice was essentially a city-state with land holdings in northern Italy and a maritime empire in the Mediterranean. At first, the Venetians thought they could survive as a great power by playing off the new Renaissance nation-states one against the other and by using them to wipe out the enemies of Venice. As soon as Louis XI was dead, the Venetians invited his unworthy heir, Charles VIII, to conquer Milan. The French conquered Naples, Florence, and Milan as well. As Venice expected, Spain opposed the French. It was a time of rapidly shifting alliances. Before long, the main powers had all been antagonized by Venetian perfidy and geopolitics. The Venetians had been filching territory on all sides, grabbing for every fly that flew by. French and imperial envoys began meeting in a town called Cambrai, then in Holland, now in France. What followed was the War of the League of Cambrai, the Great World War that marked the opening of the modern era and determined the character of present history. If Venice had been destroyed in this war, the European oligarchy would have been deprived of its leading center and would have perished. Without Venice, we would have been spared the wars of religion, including the 30 Years' War. We would have been spared the British Empire and most of its wars, including the American Civil War and the two world wars of this century, to say nothing of countless economic crises and depressions. At the heart of the League of Cambrai was the joint commitment in 1508 by King Louis XII of France and Maximilian, the Holy Roman Emperor, to divide the territory of Venice between them. Maximilian was not a philanthropist. He was greedy for territory and loot. The King of Spain joined in because he wanted to take the Venetian possessions in southern Italy. A little later, Pope Julius II della Rovere joined the League. Julius was a soldier and an oligarch. He was called the Papa Terribile. His portrayal as Michelangelo's patron by Rex Harrison in the movie The Agony and the Ecstasy is much too kind. The Venetians, the masters of geopolitics and encirclement, were faced in 1509 by a league of virtually all the European states, with the exceptions of Hungary and of England. In Venice, the Council of Ten took over emergency powers. The program of the League of Cambrai was to expropriate all Venetian territories except for the city itself inside its lagoon. Since Venetian wealth derived more from land possessions than from ocean trade, a loss of the land empire, or terra firma, would have been a fatal blow. Among the French, there were those who wanted to go further. The French general Bayard, proverbial for his courage, proclaimed the destruction of the Venetian oligarchy because of their opulent contempt for God and for Christendom. In the spring of 1509, a French army of 20,000 soldiers left Milan and crossed the Adda River into Venetian territory. On May 14th, 1509, this French force met and destroyed the Venetian mercenary army at a place called Agnadello. In the rout, the Venetians lost Verona, Bergamo, Brescia, Vicenza, and even Padua. They retreated into the natural fortress of their lagoons. The entire Venetian land empire had been lost in a single day. In one battle, Venice had dropped off the list of European great powers. The Venetians called it a second Cannae. The Florentine secretary, Machiavelli, exulted that in one day, the Venetians had lost the fruits of 800 years of aggression. The Venetians were able to retake Padua, but then they had to defend it for months against the German emperor and 100,000 troops. Maximilian said he wanted to divide Venice into four occupation zones and give each ruler of a Cambrai power a palace in his own zone. Only twice before had the Venetians been in such dire straits. Once in 810 AD, during the attack of Pippin of France, the heir of Charlemagne, and again during the war with the Genoese in 1379. There was also bad news for Venice on the trade war front. A few months before this battle, the Venetians had received news of the naval battle of Diu, in which an Egyptian fleet, supported by Indian princes, had been wiped out by the Portuguese navy. This meant that the old Venetian monopoly in the spice trade with the East was now a dead duck. At first, the beleaguered Venetians were totally isolated, but then they discovered a friend, the new King of England, Henry VIII. Advised by Cardinal Wolsey and the Cecils, Henry VIII urged Pope Julius to betray the League of Cambrai and to ally himself with Venice. Henry VIII offered the Venetians a loan and signed a friendship treaty with them. Pope Julius II de la Rovere now carried out an act of betrayal second only to that of Judas Iscariot. He reversed his alliances, breaking the League of Cambrai. By February 1510, the turncoat Julius was allied with Venice in exchange for some territorial concessions and a few bribes. In the summer of 1510, the French and imperial forces reached the lagoons for a second time. This would have been the best chance to annihilate Venice, but Julius attacked them on their flank. Venice was preserved. Julius II must bear the historical responsibility of permitting the survival of Venice and of thus transmitting oligarchy into the modern world. 1511 brought a third Franco-imperial offensive, which once again reached the shores of the lagoon. But now Spain followed Julius and joined the Venetian Papal Alliance against France and the Empire. Henry VIII also joined this Holy League as a pretext for attacking France, still the most anti-Venetian power. In the spring of 1512, there came a new shift. Emperor Maximilian decided to join Venice, the Pope, and Spain against the French. Now it was all against one, and that one was France. The Venetians took advantage by reoccupying their ruined land empire for the third time. In February of 1513, Julius II de la Rovere, the man who unleashed the scourge of oligarchy on our modern world, finally died. About a month later, the Venetians, desperately maneuvering to avoid being despoiled by their nominal allies, sealed their alliance with France. As a result, General Cardona, the Spanish general, attacked Venice. From the top of their bell towers, the Venetians watched as the Spaniards burned the towns along the edge of the lagoon and fired their huge cannon into the city itself. Venice had been brought to the verge of perdition for the fourth time, but Cardona had to retreat. The war dragged on through 1514. In September 1515, the French and the Venetians finally won the key battle of Marignano near Milan. After that, only Verona remained in the hands of the German Emperor Maximilian. And with him, Venice finally signed a peace in 1517. But it still seemed a question of time before Venice were finally overrun. But in that same war year of 1517, a desperate Venetian wartime operation, masterminded by Gasparo Contarini, succeeded when Luther nailed his theses to the door of Wittenberg Cathedral. Henceforward, the conflicts between Catholics and Protestants in Germany and elsewhere began to relieve the pressure on Venice. Venice was 5 million ducats in debt. For 8 years, Venice had been trampled by the endless maneuvers of the huge armies. Only the wars of religion among and inside the other Cambrai powers saved Venice from being finally crushed. In retrospect, the biggest loser in the War of the League of Cambrai was humanity itself.
What does all this have to do with the price of beans? All this ancient history is irrelevant. History is a bunch of bunk anyway, don't you think, Reggie?
Well, Tom, I've always had a soft spot for the Venetians. I've always taken my Venetian connections very seriously. The Venetians had the idea that if you controlled culture and the mind, you could control the world. If you controlled culture You control the way people think. It wouldn't matter anymore what might happen because you controlled people's reactions to any event. And then it didn't matter what would actually happen. Oh, the Venetians. They can be imitated, but never equaled, I fear.
Reggie, I don't get it.
Oh, pardon me, Tom. I'm not being practical. You're absolutely right. And this bloke is speaking bloody nonsense.
The outcome of the War of the League of Cambrai left us with an impacted, bifurcated European civilization. Renaissance science and statecraft survived, but marginalized, weakened, and drained by the oligarchical parasite. Oligarchism is the AIDS of civilization, and we are now living in the final phase, the dementia. Venice had survived. There remained the question of how this small and weak state could infect future humanity with its contagion. Part of the answer was the metastasis of the Venetian oligarchical cancer to take over a large modern state. The Venetians eventually chose England, the power that had been most friendly during the late war. But the roots of Venetian and Byzantine influence in England were centuries old, going back to the Norman conquest of 1066. During the 1200s, King Henry III of England was bankrupted by loans masterminded by the Venetians. When Edward III started the Hundred Years' War against France around 1340, he acted as an instrument of Venice. Venice wanted no French interference with their wars of those times against Genoa. The Wars of the Roses had been fought by factions egged on by the Venetians, who viewed Wat Tyler's rebellion and Wycliffe's Lollards as a dress rehearsal for Luther. Venetian factions were dominant at the court of King Henry VIII. So the Venetians moved their family fortunes and their characteristic world outlook to wretched England. But the Venetian party in England was only a part of the answer. As long as the forward motion of the Renaissance science continued, the Venetians, the British, and all the others would be forced to imitate it and duplicate it on pain of being militarily defeated. But irrational domination by oligarchs could not coexist with continuous progress in science and technology. The Venetians could not simply attack science from the outside. They needed to seize control of science and corrupt it from within. This task fell to the Venetian intelligence leader, Paolo Sarpi, who lived between 1552 and 1623. Sarpi became one of the most famous persons in Europe as Venetian propaganda boss during the Pope's interdict against Venice in 1606-1607. Sarpi organized the assassination of King Henry IV of France in 1610. And with the help of his assets at the court of Frederick V in Heidelberg, Sarpi was decisive in starting the 30 Years' War, which killed half of the population of Germany and one-third of the population of Europe as a whole. But Sarpi's most lasting achievement is the launching of the European Enlightenment, including both the Bacon, Hobbes, Locke, Newton, Berkeley, Hume, English empiricism, and the Descartes, Voltaire, Rousseau, French Encyclopedia school. Sarpi was a Servite monk of modest origins. Early in life, he became an admirer of William of Ockham, one of the stupidest of the medieval nominalist philosophers. Sarpi was also a follower of Pomponazzi, the Venetian professor who argued that man has no soul. Sarpi was a creature of the Contarini and Morosini families, who were committed to the Venetian metastasis into Northern Europe. Sarpi rose to be number two in the Servite order. He lived in Rome and knew the main personalities of the Counter-Reformation, including Borromeo, Bellarmino, Pope Sixtus V, and the future Pope Urban VII. When the Contarini-Morosini faction, called the Giovanni Party, became dominant in the 1580s, Sarpi became, in the words of the papal nuncio, the boss of half of Venice. He ran a tea group for patrician Calvinists and libertines, which the Vatican attacked as an academy of errors. The leading British authority on Sarpi today is H.R. Trevor Roper, Lord Dacre, who calls the friar an indefatigable polymath, or master of all the sciences. In reality, Sarpi was the greatest corrupter of modern science, the greatest charlatan of all time. It is his doctrines which are taught in the universities today. In astronomy and physics, Sarpi was the case officer who directed the work of the Padua professor Galileo Galilei. Galileo called Sarpi a mathematician without equal in Europe. Contemporaries recognized that Sarpi had been the advisor, author, and director of Galileo's telescope project. Sarpi provided the telescope, and Galileo's alleged observations were done from Sarpi's monastery. The telescope itself had been invented by Leonardo long before. Galileo was, until the end of his life, a paid agent of the Sarpi group. Sarpi also tried to build up a reputation as an expert in magnetism. It fascinated him because of its magical overtones. Sarpi was famous as a mathematician and probably wrote a treatise of mathematics which was lost when his monastery burned in 1769. In anatomy, the Venetians claimed that Sarpi had been the first to discover the valves in the human veins, and even that he had been the first to describe the circulation of the blood before Harvey. Sarpi wrote a history of the Council of Trent, and his influence on historiography has been immense. The pro-Venetian writer, John Milton, used Sarpi as a major source, praising him as the great unmasker of the papacy. Edward Gibbon, the author of The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, was of course the leading historical figure of the British Venetian party during the 18th century. In his great tome, Gibbon wrote, "Should Rome and her religion be annihilated, Sarpi's golden volume may still survive, a philosophical history and a salutary warning." Lord Thomas Babington Macaulay, the Venetian party historian of the 19th century, was also an avid admirer of Sarpi. For today's Lord Dacre or Trevor Roper, Sarpi was simply the greatest of all the Catholic historians. So Sarpi was indeed a prodigy among the oligarchs. But what of Sarpi, the philosopher of scientific method? Sarpi never published a work of philosophy, but the Venetian archives were found to contain his philosophical manuscripts, The Art of Thinking Well and The Thoughts, which were published in 1910 and again more fully in 1951. Here we find that Sarpi single-handedly created the basis of modern empiricism. He taught that scientific truth was not to be found in Aristotle, but rather written in mathematical characters in the great book of life. The way to get this truth was to use Aristotle's sense certainty, but now in the form of experiments. Specific findings of Aristotle or of the medieval scholastics could be junked, but Aristotle's overall domination was to be preserved. Francis Bacon and Thomas Hobbes were the two founders of British empiricism. Both of them understood Italian. They and their protector, the Earl of Devonshire, corresponded with Sarpi and his group, with Hobbes doing the translation. Hobbes and the Earl visited Venice in September 1614, and in all probability met Sarpi. Bacon's inductive method is simply a bowdlerization of Sarpi. Hobbes belonged to the Sarpi networks all his life. The plan for Hobbes's career as a writer emerged from his meeting with Galileo in 1636, when Galileo suggested that Hobbes write a book of ethics according to the mathematical geometrical method. After that, Hobbes went around blathering that motion, Galilean motion, was the only thing that mattered. One of Sarpi's aphorisms reads, "From the weakness of man derives his characteristic of living in society, but from man's depravity derives the need to live under a supreme authority." This, along with Sarpi's favorite theme of church-state conflict, is the main issue in Hobbes's Leviathan. When Hobbes lived in Paris during the English Civil War, he rubbed elbows with a Venetian clique around Mersenne, Descartes, and Gassendi. Hobbes and Descartes quarreled, but also partied together. Then there is the question of Locke. Locke was a plagiarist of Sarpi. And for this, we have the testimony of no less a personage than the Doge of Venice, a mid-18th century Doge, Marco Foscarini. Doge Foscarini wrote that Sarpi's art of thinking well is the original from which Locke copied. An extraordinary statement for a Doge. Grit your teeth, and we will show Sarpi as the basis of Locke's 1689 essay concerning human understanding. Better 5 minutes of pain now than 1,000 pages of Locke. Locke's first book argues that the mind is a blank slate without any inborn or innate ideas. This meshes exactly with Sarpi, who, like Aristotle and Pomponazzi, tries to show that nothing enters the mind except through the senses. The corollary of this is that there is no human soul. Sarpi thus denies creativity and exalts absolute evil. Every body which moves operates on what it touches. That is Sarpi's point of departure. Sarpi shows how external objects operate on our senses, distinguishing between the object which creates the sensation and the sensation itself. The sensations we feel are not the qualities of the objects, but phenomena of our intellect. The senses deliver the sensations through the nervous system. Then what Sarpi calls discursive reasoning, or the active intellect, assigns the ideas numbers, sizes, and so forth. This discursive reasoning orders, combines, compares the sense ideas which have been stored in memory. Locke's second book is a carbon copy of all this. In The Art of Thinking Well, Sarpi writes, knowledge by experience is of greater certainty than knowledge through reason, and no reason can ever manage to equal experience. Locke's second book states very similarly that all our knowledge is founded on and derives itself from experience. For Locke, experience comes from sensation or from reflection. Reflection meaning sense impressions already stored in the brain. Sarpi uses exactly the same term of reflection to distinguish between cognition and the later examination of that same cognition. Sarpi talks about compound ideas, the ones made up of more than one simple sense impression. So does Locke. Sense impressions in general do not err, says Sarpi, although sometimes impaired vision or the like can cause distortions, and discursive reasoning can become confused. Locke's second book has similar remarks, with a remark about color blindness. Sarpi and Locke both treat methods for fixing the mistakes that creep into our processing of sense ideas. Sarpi argues that the intellect orders ideas according to notions of genus, species, and essence. In Locke's third book, we read, all the great business of genus and species and essence amounts to no more than this, that men enable themselves to consider things in bundles. Sarpi has the same bundles. He goes on from them to talk about definitions and then axioms. Locke also treats axioms, which he prefers to call maxims. He argues that they are of limited utility, serving mainly to silence opponents in debates. Sarpi also mistrusts axioms and asserts that knowledge is actually harmful and that animals are better off in their natural ignorance than we are. Sarpi and Locke talk about syllogisms. Here also they agree. Sarpi warns that syllogisms can also be perverse in form. Locke wants to show that he is fully modern and in no way an old-fashioned scholastic or schoolman. He denies every claim made for the syllogism, although he then hastens to add that this does not in the least diminish the prestige of Aristotle. Sarpi ends with some words on language, saying that words were invented not to identify things, but rather the ideas of the speaker. Locke reproduces the same argument in toto, stating that all words signify nothing immediately but the ideas in the mind of the speaker. Sarpi regards words as sources of confusion, error, and abuse, and so does Locke. Sarpi has used 22 pages, while Locke has required just short of 1,000. The Venetian party was apparently paying Locke by the page. Most of Locke's modern editors and biographers make no mention of Sarpi, but a catalog of Locke's library shows a lively interest in the Venetian. Locke owned at least one copy of every book that Sarpi had ever published for a total of 13 volumes. So Sarpi, whatever his obscurity, is the founder of modern British empiricism. He is the chief philosophical guru of the British Empire and of the English-speaking peoples, including most Americans today. In this way, Sarpi has become the most popular and influential thinker of the modern world. The dead hand of Paolo Sarpi is reaching out of the sarcophagus once again, threatening to throttle world civilization. Oligarchism is the AIDS of civilization, and we're in the final stage, the stage of dementia. To find a cure, we must examine the etiology of the infection. How did we get here? For three centuries after Louis XI, his heirs in France were the main world opposition against the Venetian party. But by the closing decades of the 18th century, France was no longer able to contain the Anglo-Venetian British Empire. But then a new power emerged, holding out the promise of liberating the world from oligarchy and salvaging the lost war of the League of Cambrai.
In the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another and to assume among the powers of the earth that separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them. A decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or abolish it and to institute new government, laying its foundations on such principles and organizing its power in such form as to them shall seem most likely to effect their safety and happiness. These great ideals of the Declaration of Independence announced the separation of the United States of America from the British Empire. But as Abraham Lincoln, Martin Luther King, and other great Americans understood, these ideals also promised the ultimate elimination of imperialism from the face of the earth. Standing before Independence Hall in Philadelphia on February 22, 1861, Abraham Lincoln explained that the great principle of the Declaration was not the mere matter of the separation of the colonies from the motherland, but something in that Declaration giving liberty not alone to the people of this country, but hope to the world for all future time. It was that which gave promise that in due time the weights should be lifted from the shoulders of all men, that all should have an equal chance. If this country cannot be saved, Lincoln said, without giving up that principle, I was about to say that I would rather be assassinated on this spot than to surrender it. Yet, throughout our history, and perhaps never more than at this moment, these ideals have been under attack, and the greatest enemy of these ideals and these principles is and always has been John Locke. Ah, but your neighbor, the typical American, might object. How can an English philosopher who died in 1704 and who hardly anyone knows anything about, possibly influence anything today? But does that neighbor believe that the government budget is like a household budget? Does he or she believe that government should not interfere with a free market? Does he or she believe that the profit motive, that greed motivates people, that poverty is caused by immorality among the poor, that welfare recipients are bums who should be forced to work, that children should be given practical job training in school, that experience is the best teacher, and that all of this nonsense represents true Americanism? Or does your neighbor believe that America was based on slave labor, that the founding fathers were all wealthy hypocrites who cared only about preserving their own property and who just didn't want to pay their taxes? If your neighbors believe any of this foolishness, then they are suffering from the continuing influence of John Locke as promoted by agencies such as the Locke Institute at George Mason University in Fairfax, Virginia, run by a British professor of economics from the Mont Pelerin Society, or by the National Park Service, which presents Locke to tourists in Philadelphia as a major intellectual influence on the Declaration of Independence itself, or, in fact, by almost every textbook and reference book on the American Revolution ever printed in the 20th century. A pattern of lying about Locke and America, which was set by Lord Bertrand Russell's Fractured History of Western Philosophy, which strains mightily to portray John Locke as a virtual founding father. In reality, John Locke and his ideology were and are the greatest enemy of America. They represent the very thing against which the American Revolution was fought. To demolish the myth of John Locke, to thereby overturn this whole latticework of lies, this is the key to unlocking the minds of our fellow citizens. What did John Locke actually stand for? Locke stood for feudalism. In 1669, he wrote the Fundamental Constitutions for the Government of Carolina. Locke established 8 lords proprietors of Carolina as a hereditary nobility to avoid, he said, erecting a numerous democracy. Locke stood for white slavery or serfdom. His Constitution of Carolina established the category of leetman or serf, who would be bought and sold along with the land. All the children of leetmen shall be leetmen, Locke said, and so to all generations. Locke stood for black chattel slavery. He wrote that every free man of Carolina shall have absolute power and authority over his Negro slaves, of what opinion or religion soever. Locke stood for British imperialism. That is the unbridled taxation, exploitation, and political repression of the American colonies. From 1672 to 74, Locke served as secretary of King Charles II's Council of Trade and Foreign Plantations. Locke's council passed the infamous Navigation Acts and other measures designed to maintain the colonies as a source of loot for the mother country. In 1696, Locke was appointed to the new Board of Trade by King William. The board passed a new, more oppressive Navigation Act, a Woolen Act prohibiting the export of all woolen products from America, along with other acts suppressing colonial manufacturing and political freedom. In 1701, Locke's board demanded the revocation of all colonial charters and the imposition of direct imperial rule. These were the very measures condemned in the Declaration of Independence, the long train of abuses and usurpations, all having in direct object the establishment of an absolute tyranny over these states. But there is much more. Locke was a founding investor in the Bank of England in 1694, the mother of the Federal Reserve and the International Monetary Fund. As such, Locke invoked free market principles to defend the practice of usury. He demanded that England reap the profits of the world through control of world trade, arguing, "It is with a kingdom as with a family. Spending less than our commodities will pay for is a sure and only way for the nation to grow rich." It was service to the Bank of England that brought Locke into partnership with Isaac Newton, a greedy, pathetic misanthrope steeped in witchcraft and alchemy, who British propaganda had transformed into a demigod. In 1696, Newton obtained the very lucrative position and appointment as warden and later master of the British Mint, and spent the last 30 years of his life as a ruthless hatchet man for America's deadly enemies among the British financial oligarchy. As the usury and exploitation of the Bank of England impoverished the nation, filling the streets with whole families of destitute beggars, Locke was quick to blame it on what he called the debauchery of the poor, the relaxation of discipline and corruption of manners. Locke proposed a new poor law in 1697, that all men begging in maritime counties without passes, that are maimed or above 50 years of age, shall be sent to the next house of correction, there to be kept at hard labor for 3 years. Locke also demanded that the children of laboring people above 3 and under 14 years of age be forced to attend what he called a working school, where they would spin wool with both hands all day. Locke said, "If therefore care be taken that they have each of them their belly full of bread at school," Locke wrote, "they will be in no danger of famishing." And to this also may be added, without any trouble, in cold weather, if it be thought needful, a little warm water gruel, for the same fire that warms the room may be made use of to boil a pot of it. John Locke is the consummate ideologue of oligarchy, the very antithesis of the republic of the nation state. Plato defined oligarchy as the regime founded on a property assessment in which the rich rule and the poor man has no part in ruling office. For Locke, the great and chief end of men uniting into commonwealths and putting themselves under government is the preservation of their property. In opposition to the Declaration of Independence, Locke proclaims the inalienable rights of life, liberty, and property. He insists that a person without property, like a slave, is outside of civil society and therefore has no rights which the propertied classes are bound to respect. The great adversary of Locke, of Newton, and of the British Empire was and is Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. Leibniz, the master strategist, Platonic philosopher and scientist, organized a far-flung network of correspondents and co-conspirators in every possible corner of the globe to advance a worldwide grand design, an alliance of sovereign nation-states pursuing economic development, scientific and technological progress, including the early development of steam power and the science of dynamics, all in direct conflict with the budding British Empire. Leibniz advanced the idea of the scientific academy or society, developed in the France of Louis XI and Jean-Baptiste Colbert, as an instrument of the nation-state to promote the general welfare through science, technology, education, and public works. On this basis, Leibniz and his collaborator, Denis Papin, developed the first steam engine using a piston and cylinder in 1690. By 1707, They had improved the device and used it to power a model paddle wheel ship. Leibniz had also managed to place himself in a position to personally crush the empire in the egg. In 1701, he had arranged, in cooperation with his allies in England, to make his brilliant student and protectress, the Electress Sophie of Hanover, the next in line of succession to the British throne. Leibniz, the possible prime minister of the next Queen of England, became the rallying point for anti-imperialist factions in England and the American colonies. When John Locke published his despicable essays on human understanding in 1690, it was Leibniz who rallied the opposition and authored the new essays on human understanding, a 700-page refutation of virtually every paragraph of Locke, where Locke plagiarizes Aristotle, claiming that the newborn human mind is a blank slate and that all knowledge comes from animal-like experience of pleasure and pain, and denies the existence of innate ideas, by which he means ideas of universal morality, creativity, virtue, and love. Leibniz upholds the view of Plato and proves that the innate creative power of the human mind defines the sacredness of human life and the principles of morality binding on all men, including the rich.
How appalling! This rogue doesn't understand the first thing about the Enlightenment. The great idea in those days was to be scientific, to reduce everything to numbers and to plot them on a graph. Anything else was the old medieval metaphysical rubbish. And the only one who supported that claptrap was the ridiculous German Leibniz.
No metaphysics for me either. Thanks, but no thanks. And Newton invented the calculus. Everybody knows that. It's in every textbook I've ever read.
Leibniz is irrelevant. Irrelevant, do you hear? He doesn't even appear in the great books of the Western world.
Leibniz prophetically condemns the followers of Locke. Who, Leibniz writes, believing themselves released from the troublesome fear of an overseeing providence and of a menacing future, give loose reins to their brutish passions and turn their mind to the seduction and corruption of others. And if they are ambitious and of a disposition somewhat harsh, they will be capable for their pleasure or advancement of setting on fire the four corners of the earth. Boldly they scoff at the love of country. They ridicule those who care for the public. And when any well-meaning man speaks of what will become of posterity, they reply, "We shall see when the time comes." But, Leibniz warned, these persons will possibly experience themselves the evils they think reserved for others. If, however, this disease of an epidemic mind, whose bad effects begin to be visible, is corrected, these evils will perhaps be prevented. But, Leibniz said, if it goes on increasing, Providence will correct men by the revolution which must spring therefrom. Locke and Leibniz clash as well on the crucial idea of the pursuit of happiness. Locke defines happiness as the utmost pleasure we are capable of. For Leibniz, Plato, and the American founders, the pursuit of ephemeral, sensual pleasure is not happiness. The possession of mere property, which soon decays and dies, that is not happiness, but rather the lasting pleasure of art and invention, the exercise of creative reason. And since the fruit of creative reason can only be preserved for posterity by a good government and good laws, the pursuit of happiness, in the sense of Leibniz and Plato, as opposed to that of Locke, must lead to the founding of republics. Such are the true philosophical roots of the American Revolution. The history books will tell you that an abstruse mathematical dispute arose in this period, starting about 1710, between Isaac Newton and Gottfried Leibniz, a dispute over who was the first to invent the calculus. The reality is that the so-called Newton-Leibniz controversy was a desperate political ploy, a frame-up of Leibniz on the false charge of plagiarism by a kangaroo court run by Newton personally, designed to defame Leibniz and discredit his ideas in England. When the reigning Queen Anne and the Electress Sophie both died in 1714, and the brutish George I became the first British king, the assault against Leibniz took on the proportions of a witch hunt against all those who still question the cult of Locke and Newton being imposed by the empire. Despite all of this, in the last 2 years of his life, Leibniz succeeded in forcing an open debate with Newton and his controllers, Samuel Clark and the Venetian Antonio Conti, a debate immortalized as the Leibniz-Clark correspondences. Leibniz exposed the Newtonian dogma of indivisible hard atoms interacting randomly in the vacuum of empty space as a false, impossible, and immoral doctrine. Leibniz proved, rather, that there can be no such thing as an ultimate particle or isolated individual, that there is nothing fallow, nothing empty, nothing sterile, nothing dead in the universe, no chaos, no confusion, except in appearance. That, he said, there always remain in the depths of things slumbering parts which must yet be awakened and become greater and better. And hence, Leibniz said, progress never comes to an end. Such seemingly abstract philosophical ideas represented the greatest mortal threat to the empire. These ideas were, for example, the practical basis for the steam engine project of Leibniz and Denis Papin. To penetrate into the depths of things, to awaken the slumbering parts, to harness the force of fire, of explosions, and of expanding steam, to run factories, power carriages and ships, to unleash a technological revolution capable of overthrowing the oligarchical system. With Leibniz so defined as the most feared and despised adversary of the British Empire and of British liberal philosophy, what greater proof can there be of the anti-Newtonian roots of the American Revolution than the fact that the leadership of colonial America openly took the side of Leibniz against Newton and the intellectual imperialists of London? James Logan, the fighting Quaker of colonial Pennsylvania, was the secretary of William Penn and the owner of the greatest library of classical works in America. It was to Logan's Philadelphia that Boston's Cotton Mather deployed his young protege, Benjamin Franklin, in 1723. The writings and correspondences of Logan in this period represent nothing less than a declaration of intellectual independence from Britain. 'Tis certain the world was obliged only to Leibniz for the publication of that method, the calculus, Logan declared in 1727. Logan examined Newton's method of fluxions for himself and declared it to be utterly worthless. Logan denounced Newton as mentally incompetent. He exposed the controversy with Leibniz as politically motivated and refuted and ridiculed Newton's writings on history and prophecy. With Franklin and his circle of young worker intellectuals frequenting his home and library, Logan resolved to write his own philosophical tract designed as an American refutation of what he called the detestable notion and pernicious thesis of Thomas Hobbes. This work, The Duties of Man as They May Be Deduced from Nature, was lost in England and only rediscovered at the Historical Society of Pennsylvania in 1971. The work not only demolishes Hobbes, but directly and boldly challenges Locke's authority and attacks him by name repeatedly, especially on what Logan calls Locke's unhappy mistake in the subject of morals. Logan's manuscript includes his answer to Locke after the moral sense and foundation of virtue is stated. Logan's notes for this section include an extensive, detailed list of references to Locke's essay on human understanding, which Logan used in his rebuttal of Locke on the issue of morality. Most outrageous to Logan is Locke's assertion that parents do not really love their children, but rather only feel pleasure when they do well. Logan's note reads, "Locke, that pleasure and pain are the root of all the passions, and that a father loves his child because he delights in his doing well. Most absurd." Logan also challenges Newtonian orthodoxy in a way which provides a key to understanding the true revolutionary significance of Franklin's scientific work. Logan writes about electricity, explaining that it was formerly regarded as but a trifling appearance in nature, just little sparks caused by friction or static electricity. But, Logan suggests, perhaps further research in this area may revolutionize our understanding of the universe. And, he said, if there be no heresy in mentioning it in the present age, why may we not venture to question the reasonableness of asserting a vacuum as indispensably necessary to the continuance of motion? Can we be sure that there is no electric or elastic medium that instead of obstructing or retarding motion may be the very means of continuing it? To have all space, Logan said, in the universe possessed by some kind of matter is much more consistent with the dignity, beauty, and order of the whole than to imagine those vast voids which carry even a kind of horror in the thought. The circles of Logan and Franklin were all militantly anti-Newtonian, self-proclaimed heretics against the orthodox doctrine. The New Yorker Cadwallader Colden proudly compared his scientific ideas to Leibniz's theory of monads. The South Carolinian Alexander Garden attacked the British Royal Society as lazy, indolent, conceited, and prejudiced against Americans, and promoted Leibniz as a great scientific authority. Another New Yorker, John Rutherford, supported Leibniz's philosophy and wrote scathingly of Newton, "Nor can I ever envy a man or call him truly great who never enjoyed any pleasure in society, died a virgin, and wrote upon the revelations." Even the infamous Leonhard Euler of the Berlin Academy, the greatest traitor to Leibniz on the continent of Europe, intervened to attack the Americans and defend Newton's reputation. Franklin began his electrical researches just after Logan wrote and circulated his ideas. It was Franklin who transformed the study of electricity from a parlor game into a serious science. who invented the concept and the terms of positive and negative charge, and who laid the foundation for the future electrical transformation of the world. Franklin carried out his famous kite experiment in June of 1752, proving the identity of lightning and electricity, which he says was laughed at by the connoisseurs of the British Royal Society. He attached a pointed wire to a kite and tied a key to the string near his hand. He flew the kite in a thunderstorm, and at great risk to his own life, he snatched lightning from the heavens. Franklin had proved Logan's conjecture about electricity, that it is more than a trifling thing, that it must, he said, in some fashion permeate the universe, in direct contradiction to the Newtonian dogma of vast voids and empty space. In a letter to Colden, just weeks before his experiment, Franklin made it clear that the objective of his electrical research was the overthrow of the Newtonian system. "'Tis well," Franklin wrote, "we are not subject to the Inquisition for philosophical heresy. My whispers against the orthodox doctrine in private letters would be dangerous, but one heretic will surely excuse another."
As a member of the American Philosophical Society, James Alexander was the astronomer in charge of American preparations in 1753 to record the transit of Mercury. He also organized support for Franklin's first attempt to politically unify the colonies, the 1754 Albany Plan of Union. His son, William Alexander, became one of George Washington's most trusted generals during the American Revolution. To bug the British during the war, he flaunted his Scottish title as Lord Stirling and helped expose the treasonous plot by the Conway Cabal in 1778 to remove Washington from command of the Continental Army. James Alexander had many blessings to count, and clearly it helps to defy the axioms of imperial opinion, especially if you wish to become a scientist and a philosopher and build a republic. The pursuit of knowledge was not going so well on the British side. The English artist William Hogarth, another friend of Jonathan Swift, commented on the problem in a 1738 engraving of a leading Oxford professor lecturing his students on the properties of a vacuum. Franklin's nation-building agenda in 1744 was not intended merely for abstract contemplation. Indeed, given Britain's authorization to mobilize for offensive war, his proposals fueled a series of bold measures to smash the long-standing wall of containment which British and French oligarchical interests had maintained. Walpole was already a dead duck, and the collapse of his government had also left significant cracks in Britain's colonial machinery. A new governor had taken office in 1741 in long-suffering Massachusetts, William Shirley, who was already familiar with the colony and with the circles of Benjamin Franklin. The French military governor commanding the new superfortress at Louisbourg launched attacks on Nova Scotia in 1744. Shirley's warnings to London that New England's fisheries were in danger went unheeded. He began formulating a plan to accomplish the impossible. He proposed to the legislature in Boston during a secret session in January 1745 that the colony immediately prepare an expedition to take Louisbourg, the greatest French fortress in the New World, on its own authority and without the involvement of Britain. After recovering from shock, the legislators approved the plan, authorized bills of credit to pay for it, and mobilized more than 3,000 Massachusetts militiamen, a squadron of ships totaling over 200 guns, all the artillery they could get their hands on, and 90 ocean-going transports. After The fleet sailed from Nantasket Roads on March 24th, 1745. Shirley sent a letter to London, which he knew would take 2 months to get there, informing His Majesty's government that New England forces would besiege Louisburg with 4,000 men. The plan was so bold, even down to attacking the fortress from behind at a point which the French thought impossible, that it worked. News reached Boston at 1 a.m. on July 3rd, 1745, that the fortress had surrendered after a lengthy and devastating siege. Bells pealed, cannon roared, cheering throngs filled the streets. Jubilant celebrations with bonfires and fireworks were held throughout the colonies as the word spread. With no assistance of any kind from Britain, untried, poorly equipped New England militiamen had taken out a French fortress boasting enormous firepower, and so vast that it contained an entire city within its walls. It was a stunning victory, especially in the minds of Britain's ruling circles, who regarded it, one might say, as a horrifying triumph. Americans eagerly anticipated the imminent removal of the French Jesuit Indian threat to the colonies and a British military follow-up on their spectacular achievement in the opening round. But British and French oligarchical circles were already at work redrawing future settlements to preserve their joint containment. The British decided merely to project the illusion of supporting the colony's hopes until the opportunity to take Canada had passed. Meanwhile, Louisburg was to be held at American expense, with nothing more from Britain than the promise that the garrison would be relieved by troops from Gibraltar someday. More than 3,000 New England militiamen remained encamped at Louisburg in the summer of 1745. Their siege had reduced most of the quarters within the fortress to ruins, and relief was urgently needed. The drinking wells were dangerously contaminated, and the island was completely dependent on external supplies. A major military and civil reconstruction effort was required, but 2 months passed with no sign of activity from London. Rumors spread in Boston that Britain was planning to return Louisburg to the French. His Majesty's government threw a bone to Governor Shirley, appointing him a colonel in the British Army to command regiments to be raised in America. Officers' commissions had been claimed for the British, however, and Shirley reported, "Men will not enlist here except under American officers." The British, meanwhile, left the New England regiments at Louisburg to twist in the wind. All through the fall, and further isolated during the long winter, suffering from fevers, dysentery, and lack of supplies, they waited in vain for the relief promised from Britain. By the time a modest detachment of troops arrived from Gibraltar in April 1746, 10 months after the French surrender, nearly 900 New England militiamen had died. The survivors finally sailed for home, most of them from Massachusetts, bringing with them a deepening hatred of British rule. America's future was beginning to take shape in Boston in more ways than one, and inevitably it reflected something of the past. The leading scientist in America at the time was Harvard professor John Winthrop, the direct descendant and namesake of both the Republican founder in 1630 of the Massachusetts Bay Colony and his son, who extended that constitutional liberty during the 1660s as governor of Connecticut. The Connecticut Winthrop was a scientist in his own right and had corresponded with the young Leibniz. Professor John Winthrop held the only academic chair in science in America. Like his fellow Bostonian Benjamin Franklin, he was a protege of Cotton Mather, and like Ben, was something of a child prodigy. He was admitted to Harvard College at the age of 13 in 1728, the same year Mather died. He graduated in 1732, the year George Washington was born. and was appointed professor of mathematics and natural and experimental philosophy in 1738. We know from student lecture notes that he included Leibniz in his course of study, and that he had great fun using physical models to Socratically demolish the empiricist nonsense of Descartes. Benjamin Franklin had visited Boston in 1745 and returned again in 1746. He reports in his autobiography that it was then at Boston that he witnessed experiments in electricity, a subject quite new to me. On May 10th, 1746, John Winthrop presented at Harvard the first controlled experiments in America in electrical phenomena. He remained one of Franklin's most trusted friends throughout his life, which was ended by pneumonia in 1779. He was also at the very center of America's Republican networks. He was consulted by George Washington during the French and Indian War, and again during the Revolution, when Washington appointed him to oversee the production of munitions for the Continental Army's siege of British-occupied Boston. John Winthrop's students included John Adams, Sam Adams, and John Hancock, who were in constant communication with him during the Revolution. When John Adams agonized over whether the Continental Congress should declare independence from Britain, Winthrop warned him in April 1776 that unless the decision were made pretty soon, Massachusetts would do it for themselves. In 1746, after the capture of Louisburg, the British had learned what Massachusetts could do on its own and already feared the threat of American independence. His Majesty's government, as Franklin later charged, affected to entertain a project for the reduction of Canada, merely by way of a feint to secure peace. The British went so far as to load up an expeditionary force on transports at Portsmouth, England, providing grounds for military countermeasures against America by France. Lord John Russell, a cabinet member from one of Britain's most infamous ruling families, then objected that a British expedition might further a tendency toward independence by the colonies. The troops were unloaded, the expedition was canceled. Jesuit-run tribes, meanwhile, had overrun settlements from Rochester, New Hampshire to Saratoga, New York, and in 1746 seized Fort Massachusetts, the key to that colony's western defense. Within lands claimed by Virginia beyond the Ohio River, the French were building up Forts Miami, Ouiatineau, and Vincennes. In the summer of 1747, a French raiding party even ventured up the Delaware River to within 20 miles of Philadelphia. In that same year, the British ministry declared that the American regiments must be disbanded, as it put it, as cheap as possible, and that no more military action be undertaken by the colonies. In 1748, at the Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle, ending the war in Europe, the British gave Louisburg back to the French in exchange for the port of Madras, India, and future looting by the British East India Company. A Swedish traveler in America at the time, who visited with Benjamin Franklin, reported from New York, "The English government has therefore reason to regard the French in North America as the chief power that urges their colonies to submission." If one steps back to comprehend what most Americans understood from these events during the 1740s, then one comprehends why the American Revolution was indispensable. Without it, and without the power of the United States as a constitutional republic, Western European civilization, as created by the Renaissance, would not have survived. And had colonial Americans not fought for that higher conception of man against the bestial notions of the British oligarchy, we could never have won the War of Independence. Yet the British and their American apologists, even to this day, twaddle on about their special relationship and the common bonds of the Anglo-Saxon race. The American Revolution was simply the result of a bit of misunderstanding, you see, and perhaps one or two tactical or administrative blunders.
The special relationship, Reggie, that ought to be right up your alley.
It is the very core of my existence. Blood is thicker than water. Tom, you Yanks have to choose between your Anglo-Saxon kin across the sea and those bloody wogs.
What is a wog anyway, Reggie?
Very simple. Wogs begin at Calais. I say that every time I address the House of Lords. The Anglo-American relationship is fundamental.
Sounds right to me.
Very staunch, Tom. Think of old Sir Winston. What a leader. He was always ready to fight to the very last American.
Huh?
The reality was that British policy was consistent and consistently rotten. In terms of policy essentials, what they did in the 1740s, during the War of Austrian Succession, was the same thing they did during the French and Indian War, and attempted to do again during the American Revolution and throughout our history as a nation. Simply put, their policy has always been, we will not permit the existence of an American Republic. But Americans weren't stupid. At least they weren't in the 18th century, when they also happened to have the most literate population anywhere in the world. And they had an agenda for nation building, as Franklin had summarized it in 1744 for the American Philosophical Society. The work was already underway. The new territory, which America wished to develop, was not Canada, but Virginia's vast colonial claim to the West, which then included what became the states of West Virginia, Kentucky, Ohio, Indiana, Illinois, Michigan, Wisconsin, and the portion of Minnesota east of the Mississippi River. In Virginia, in 1747, Lawrence Washington, George's older half-brother, founded the Ohio Company with the backing of Lord Fairfax, the proprietor of Virginia's northern neck, a royal grant extending across most of northern Virginia all the way to the headspring of the Potomac River in the west, deep in the Allegheny Mountains. Proposed as a private venture to circumvent direct royal government, the company proposed to settle 500,000 acres just beyond the Fairfax grant, southeast of the headwaters of the Ohio River at what is now Pittsburgh. The Crown granted the Ohio Company petition in 1748, and in March, 16-year-old George Washington set off with a small party to begin surveying the Appalachian reaches of the Fairfax grant towards the Ohio country. By the fall, the Ohio Company had begun recruiting German immigrants, especially iron workers, to overcome the shortage of skilled labor resulting from British repression of colonial iron making. Soon a string of bloomeries and forges for iron making were underway in the Shenandoah Valley. At Lancaster, Pennsylvania, skilled German metal workers began producing the first rifles in America, spiral grooved and deadly accurate at more than 250 yards. The Ohio Company was now the spearhead of a growing effort to break through to develop the West. And in 1750, the British responded in their typical fashion by issuing the infamous Iron Act, decreeing a zero-growth policy for America. Franklin drafted and privately circulated his reply in 1751, published 4 years later as his Observations Concerning the Increase of Mankind. He declared that those who devote themselves to the promoting of trade, increasing employment, improving land, etc., and the man that invents new trades, arts, or manufactures, or new improvements in husbandry, may be properly called fathers of their nation, as they are the cause of the generation of multitudes. Therefore, he said, Britain should not too much restrain manufacturers in her colonies. A wise and good mother will not do it. So much for Britain's maternal qualities. In 1754, commanding the Virginia militia, George Washington forced the issue of developing the West when he fired on French troops who had pushed into the interior of southwestern Pennsylvania at Jumonville Glen. Franklin accelerated his drive to politically unify the colonies and issued his famous cartoon summarizing the crisis for America with the motto, "Join or die." Widely reprinted at the time, it later became a symbol for the American Revolution. In the ensuing French and Indian War, Britain decided it finally had to make a show of force in support of its American colonies. And the British Army's only significant campaign on the Western frontier was designed to fail. And despite George Washington's best efforts, ended in Braddock's defeat in 1755, well before reaching Fort Duquesne. The British chose instead to attack French Canada, and with the cost of many American lives, a supposed victory was obtained. This time, His Majesty's government wanted to return all of Canada to the French, in return for the tiny island of Guadeloupe, which Britain fancied as a great convenience to its Caribbean slave trade. The furor in America, loudly conveyed in London by Franklin himself, forced the British to settle for taking Canada. The Jesuits, however, were left in place, even though they were being kicked out of both France and even the Habsburg Empire at the time. Within weeks after word of the Treaty of Paris reached America in 1763, the worst Indian war America had ever seen broke out, drawing tribes from as far away as the northern Great Plains and western Canada, leveling nearly every outpost west of the Alleghenies, and driving deep into the colonies along the Atlantic coast. It was a coordinated onslaught on a vast scale. And this time, every single assault came through territory administered by Great Britain. With professions of his infinite care for his poor subjects in America, King George III set forth in the wake of the slaughter his proclamation line, prohibiting Americans from crossing the Eastern Mountain Chain for their own safety. Not to put too fine a point on it, we told George to stuff it, and continued to explore the West and plan the roads and canals and new technologies which would be required to build a nation. I can tell you now, since it's not a secret, that we won the American Revolution. It's a fascinating story, much of which is scarcely known, and just the sort of thing you might imagine I could go on for hours about, but another time perhaps. But I will ask you to look ahead for a moment to something which occurred in 1785. When Benjamin Franklin returned following his long years in France, having negotiated a much better Treaty of Paris in 1783 on behalf of the independent United States of America. Franklin had examined some of the work on hydrodynamics by the Swiss scientist Daniel Bernoulli and was intrigued by the possibilities of water jet propulsion using a steam engine. Both Bernoulli's uncle and his father were scientific allies and contemporaries of Leibniz. Jacques Bernoulli was well known for his applications of Leibniz's calculus to problems in geometry. And Daniel's father, Jean, had played a leading role on Leibniz's behalf in the controversy with Isaac Newton. In Philadelphia, on December 2nd, 1785, Franklin presented a paper to the American Philosophical Society entitled Aids to Navigation, which included some discussion of Bernoulli's theories on water jet propulsion. In Virginia, George Washington was already discussing the possibilities for developing a steamboat using water jet propulsion with James Rumsey, his chief engineer for the Potomac Canal Company. Washington met with Rumsey at Berkeley Springs, Virginia in September 1784, while staying at Rumsey's Inn named the Sign of the Liberty Pole and Flag. Rumsey showed him a model of a mechanical boat he was working on. And Washington was so enthusiastic, he promptly wrote him a certificate of recommendation. Washington reported that he had examined the powers upon which it acts and declared that it was his opinion that the discovery is of vast importance and may be of the greatest usefulness in our inland navigation. On December 3rd, 1787, on the Potomac River at Shepherdstown, now West Virginia, James Rumsey gave a special demonstration of his water jet propelled steamboat. The turnout of cheering citizens included a large contingent of veterans and former officers of the Continental Army. This was what they had fought for.